real estate? Have you contributed to the growth of our community? Blake, can you help us continue that conversation?
Thank you. Good morning, everyone.
Good morning.
Sorry about that. So it was 40 years ago this month that I finished the ERA Cell System 100 training class in Dallas, Texas. And I drove from the northeast side of Dallas to Las Colinas, which was about halfway between Dallas and Fort Worth. Now, even in those days, the traffic patterns were, that was an easy 45 minutes to an hour drive, depending on when you left. And I thought, wow, this business requires discipline. They're asking me to be in a class at a certain time. I have to demonstrate a certain amount of skill level in order to graduate from the class. And I have to be able to present the ERA listing presentation in front of the class in order to graduate. Well, it was 8 years later that I was now the instructor of that class at the ERA regional offices in Newport Beach, California, and in Anaheim before they moved to Newport Beach. And so the first time I held a Sales System 100 class, I had 40 hours of training to do. I had never trained the material before. And I found that I went so fast that I did it in about 32 hours. So now I had to decide what to do with Friday. So I had to create my own belief system to add on to it. So I started teaching part of Mike Perry's disciplines into the ERA training program. And what do you think ERA said about that? That's not ours. We would prefer you don't do that. And I thought, huh. So people get caught up on the limits of the knowledge they want to be exposed to. And one of the biggest differences for me is why this matters. I don't want you to be limited to access to any knowledge. I want you to have all the knowledge that it takes and required to be the best person you want. If that means you want to know everything about every other real estate company in the marketplace, if that's important to you, then go learn it. If you want to learn what title companies do, you want to go down and see the title plant, can someone come to your title plant and see it for sure? Kevin?
Yeah, I'm not
seeing you right here.
Yeah. I actually enjoy getting tours of our plant.
Right? And it's, you know, when you look at our profession, Roberta, I mean, you've been around the business for more than a week, right?
I remember the ERA.
Right. So when we look at our role within the industry, it may change over time. I've had a lot of different roles. So my initial idea of what I wanted to accomplish 40 years ago was kind of naive, but very innocent, is I wanted to hand the keys to the first-time homebuyer. Then I got involved with first-time homebuyers, and they're really oh my gosh! It was a lot more fun to knock on the door and find out that somebody owned 24 properties and they were willing to listen with me than it was to work with that first-time homebuyer who couldn't figure out what they wanted. Right? So I learned that showing property in the Dallas marketplace in June, when it's 103 and 89% humidity, and you're in and out of the air conditioning, and your car actually locks with the keys still in it, and the car's running, and you're standing there with a client trying to explain why you can't get back in your car and you have nowhere to go, that you're not a very good buyer's agent. And that was me. I was so excited, I actually left my car running to keep it cool. And I pushed the handle down on my car, shut the door, and we were locked. And I thought, what is wrong with this brain? Now, would I have consciously done that? No. I didn't get up that morning and say, hey, I want to experience this. I want to see what it's like. And so when you look at your career, are things going to go wrong? I told my brother this morning that Wade already got his real estate license, and he was laughing. We were talking about outdoor knocking this morning. And here he is. How old? 14 months. You know, because of the generational experience that he's going to be exposed to. He's going to know things that most kids are going to be. I mean, when Michael used to show up in the garage, and people would be like, what are you talking about? Why are you talking about valuing real estate properties. We're 16.
It's
just a party. And I'm like, I am partying. It's exciting. No, it's not. It's not fun. You're way too disciplined for a kid our age. Don't do this. And so when I look at this stage of my life, I think, wow, it took a lot to get here, but I'm really excited about the future. What causes that to happen? So when you look at your core, what matters to you? How about let's start with your own personal satisfaction. How many of you can get behind that? You want to be excited every day when you start your business. And when that wanes, it makes it more challenging, right? You know, ever woken up and said, I have to start doing something else today. Right? I got 3 clients I got to show. I got 2 listing appointments this weekend. I got to be out the river like everyone else. And you know what's interesting is how many people will check out right in the middle of the spring market after waiting all this time. And then they'll go, oh, you know what? I'm not as successful as I want to. But I am going to blame my company. What matters is taking personal responsibility for who you are and what you do. So when I look at our topic today, is typically the investor agent workshop, the agent investor workshop, whatever dyslexia I got going on there, we'll get it right. Consider later. The point is that we're going to focus a little bit on that, and we're also going to talk about a couple of other things. But one of the things I want to talk show is we have the marketing piece. So the other day I walked into the lobby. Now last week was a total disaster for me. And as you may have heard, I was on my way to come to the office. I had appointments booked all day long. In fact, every day last week was booked from morning till night. I had no room at all. People were asking me, can you go to the business? No, nope. I don't have anything. On the way to work, Joanne and I are carpooling and I wasn't feeling my best. And I said, Joanne, you know, I had an urgent care appointment that we got taken care of for like 9:20 over here at Anaheim Bells. And on the way down here over on the boulevard, I said, Ricky, just take it to Central Linda because I think I'm having a stroke. Honestly, I could not believe what was going on in my head. And I was spinning out of control. Everything was, everything was dizzy. I felt nauseous and all this stuff. And I thought, I am just not able to focus. And that's just not me. I don't feel like myself. So I go in there, and after a couple hours, they diagnose it as peripheral vertigo, probably driven by the fact that I had all 3 vaccines, which also have a side effect of peripheral vertigo. And I had 2 shingle shots, which also have peripheral bit of vertigo. And the pharmacist told me 3 weeks ago, stop using Zyrtec D, which is conflicting with my blood pressure medicine, and my primary care physician on Friday is saying, if I find I got your blood pressure under control. Don't listen to the pharmacist with relation to that, because I got that managed. Next time you get advice from someone else, don't take it. Call me, because I have a master plan. Right? So do our clients sometimes seek our advice, and we give it to them, we give them the whole plan, and they hear one little thing from someone else. Right? Can you tell me how much my house is worth?
Really?
So back to walking in on Monday, I have heard a rumor and seen a picture that the fountain was kind of important.
I remember
we leased this space in 2019 because we wanted to have a fountain right outside our office. So you can only imagine the emails I've had back and forth with the landlord over the last 2 years. How many times I drew my attorneys and they drew their attorneys? And I said, really? You're going to quit on that? The premier thing for the office? What are you going to do with it? Because that was a big selling point for me. To me, it's kind of like saying you're going to sell me a car and then you don't get a steering wheel. Because that first impression, right, when you can walk through the lobby and see a direct line all the way out to the mountains, it's very impressive. We all see it. So I recorded this video as my first reaction as I walked through the doors.
Okay, so you enter the space at 3111 North Tustin Street in the beautiful city of Orange, and you walk into the Crestview building, and you immediately notice in the lobby the uniqueness of the fountain, now operational after several years of remodel and renovation here in our beautiful location. Just to the left of the fountain is the entrance to Realty Pro 100. Your doorway to limitless success. Hope you have a great day. This is Blake Barkanian, Chairman, CEO, and co-founder of Realty Pro 100. Consider us as your next stop in your amazing real estate career. Have a beautiful day.
So I wanted to just record it in my natural thinking, and I was searching for words as I was walking in, and I'm on a new medication, which, to be honest, you know, I've had my moments because it's to keep me from experiencing vertigo in the middle of a presentation, and then hopefully in the next 4 to 6 weeks, everything will be fine. But the point is that we all face challenges, how we face that adversity, how we deal with the persistence of wanting what we want. Are we willing to fight a two-year battle to get what we want? So it was a year and a half ago, it was August of 2020, right in the middle of the pandemic, I'm asked to race over to a potential client's house in Anaheim. It's 104, I think, that day, and it's probably crystal clear, it's about 3 o'clock in the afternoon, and the person says, now I'm in my suit, and they said, let's go sit out by the pool. Well, and I'm standing in my suit over an hour. Was Ferris say I was there for over an hour?
Yeah.
It was hot. And then afterwards, they say, well, we're not ready yet. I'm like, and I raced over here for. Okay, any new practice. That's the way I looked at it. That's all. They're wonderful people. I love talking to wonderful people. Not so much in that text, certainly. So we face in our profession, we face all kinds of, we face adversity, we face challenges, we face opportunities. And how we deal with it is really important. So I want to ask you a question related to the agent investment workshop. So if you had a house in, let's say, Anaheim, and there's a two-story house with a pool, and it had an upstairs that could become separate from the downstairs and be fully operational as its own apartment. And this one, the downstairs, was, so this would probably be a 2-1, and this would be a 3-2. With a two-car garage, and like I said, pool. And what would the upstairs, if it was around 800 square feet, what would that rent for? And what would it rent for downstairs with 1,700 square feet if you were able to separate the two to do it perfectly? Be great. That's really close to what I was thinking.
Yeah, $6,000.
So $6,000. So if you looked at Zillow or Redfin, what do you think they say you could rent for? Around 4,000. Yeah, in the high end, if you look, so around 4,000. So we found a better way, right? Trade upstairs and downstairs. Now, if you could get that to an investor, is that house worth more money?
Yes.
How much more? Whatever the value, $2,000 extra worth of rent is? Maybe they want to make a little more than that.
Well, the garage can be turned into a really good. So that's
oh, you have a garage ceiling too!
Junior ADU,
oh!
Sounds like for me.
Way to go, Kevin! What do you mean?
All my friends time in real estate, like, why would I ever hurt my friend?
Because most people don't see that part of the vision, right? So it's actually three potential gigs. Upstairs, downstairs, garage. If you really want to keep it filling the pool, and probably build something back there.
You have to be, it has to be owner occupied to try to use that estimate. Yeah, the well, yeah. 3 years that investor doesn't want to do.
No.
You just have to say you allegedly
lie. Like Dean said, your intention. Yeah, and Dwayne was clear on that. He could sign today, said that is my intention, and your intention can change 30 seconds later.
Yeah, what are the ramifications?
I don't know.
Nobody was called.
And, no, and he says no one's ever been prosecuted in the state of California for that crime.
There hasn't been enough.
Yeah, well, I'm saying on the source, we're spreading perjury of signing that intent to you because they know it's just there to scare you, is what his point is.
Blake, in terms of value, $2,000 a month extra at a 4% cap rate is $600,000 in value.
Woo!
I like them. For less than that.
Right.
I don't know about less.
Well, I know. Just kidding. Okay. So when we look at a residential property and we're having a consultation with someone, there's multiple ways we can have that conversation, right? So we can say, you know what, I see something here that the other listing agents who you called in probably didn't know to talk to you about. And Mike just told you. I could go into homes all across the area and say, your neighbor just sold for $1.1 million, but if I could get $1.4 million for your property, would be interested in, or I would say $200,000 or $300,000 more, would be interested in learning what I mean by that? And come back tonight at 6 o'clock? How many people are going to say no? I made 85,000 for my house. That's worth 1.6 million. You think I can do it again on my next property? You know, remember we're just building it up the same percentage, 20 times? Yeah, $20 million. That's your house going to be worth. Pretty impressive, right? So when you're looking at, well, we have lots of inventory, we have 30 listings. I like 60 better. I like 70 even more. I want them to be yours. The conversation you have. So when you look at for yourself, what is it you want? What do you really want? When you say that what we do matters, why does it matter? Christina, why does it matter to you what you do what you do? I mean, if you get title from how many title companies are there?
Lawyers and architects. Come on.
No, that's in that and okay. And as long as Jason's not here, I'm sure you can. No, Kevin has said that they might be outside in the conversation that you said it. But the point is that there's competition. So you have to have a reason why that makes people say, I want to do business with you. Kevin, I first met you, it was 2005. Kevin walks through the door, and he was aware of what was important to me. He starts talking to me right away about cars.
You had the intent to kick me out that day.
I felt that about business
would have kept me.
I had to follow the company's, you know, the company's plan. It wasn't personal because I didn't know Kevin. So. Then I had to have a conversation with him at some point to actually, you know, realign his affiliation if he wanted to be part of it because that company had a restricted access that they wanted for their agents to be exposed to. And I worked in that company, and I wanted to follow what the company had. So sometimes people blame me for something that I was involved in because I had to carry out an order on behalf of someone else. One of the things I like about doing my own, having our own business, is that we get to decide what's important and what's not important. We get to focus on who we want to be in business with and who we don't want to be.
That's right.
And there'll always be some people we want to be in business with who don't want to be here. And there'll be some people who we don't want to be in business with that are here. We have to tell. We have to undo the relationship and be responsible in our behavior and how we do that. And what's that?
I'm so sorry.
You're stuck with me. I love you, Mindy. We all do. Because you know, one of the nicest things about Mindy is you always know where you stand. Right? There's never a doubt. And that's a beautiful gift you can give people, because even if you don't want to hear it, you at least know. I respect that about my beautiful wife as well, because the times where she says to me, and I'm like, That was direct. There's no doubt about it. But I like strong personalities because I have to have them. I have to remind myself from time to time, back it off a little bit. It's hard to have this fire to compete at a high level, right? Because you're torn between your own individual, what is it that I would do with me, and helping other people get what they want, who might be on a different trajectory, which is perfectly fine. You know, it's not for me to judge what someone else is. But if you asked me 30 years ago, I'd sit in total judgment. You're not going to want to be a top producer. I don't want to hang out with people because I want to be the lowest producer in the world, driven to succeed at the next highest level by the people who are pulling me up, not be the highest producer in the room where there isn't an environment that wants to support that. So I remember getting in a lot of trouble as a team leader in the past company, because I was asked, how come you're not going to the new orientation for the new team leaders in the company? I was walking the convention center in Austin, and it's September, and 100 and something degrees out, miserable. And I'm walking outside because I don't want to be inside the convention hall in the room I'm supposed to be in. And an OP from San operating principal from San Diego walks up to me and says, "What are you doing here? You're supposed to be there." And I said, "Why do I want to be in a room? This was my honest answer. Why do I want to be in a room where people won't be here 18 months from now?" And she went, "What?" And I said, "Isn't the average life expectancy of a team leader in this company 18 months?" And she said, "Yes." And I said, "I want to be in the room where the people who are running market centers that have 400 agents and above are. Because that's where I'm going. I don't want to learn what I already know, which is I know how to start a real estate company. It doesn't matter what brand's on the door. It's all about hiring quality people, right?" And have that conversation. I always find that very few people really are, if you had to choose between the people or the brand, most of us will gravitate towards people, right? Because it's the environment creating that you fit in. I don't want to work in a hostile environment. That's really important to me. I don't care what brand's on the bill. If it's hostile, I'm out. The reason I'm out is because that's how the consumer is going to be treated. And I don't want the consumer to hear, you know, to be represented by hostile people. We've seen that where some people just are really, really aggressive in our industry. And they'll disrespect someone so badly in their own living room that I'm like, I never walked into anyone's house ever in my life and said, "I'm not leaving until you listen." I never left with that mentality. When Mike Perry used to teach that, I was like, "Mike, I'm out, dude. I'm out." So what matters? That's why I'm sharing it, because that's what matters to me, because that's part of your core decision, how you want to be represented. But I can guarantee you, if that happens enough times, what's going to happen in your career? Are you going to end up with complaints against your professionalism and bad reviews on social media? As you should. What's that
saying? As you should.
As you should, because you're getting back what you deserve. So when it's all about how you make people feel, if you insult people in their own living room, it's probably not a good idea. Now then you have the predatory behavior, where it's not political, but you have someone who thinks that it's okay to invade another country and start just randomly killing people and ruining their lives. And there's actually people in the world who go, I'm okay with it. I'm okay with it. Now, wait a minute, there are many of us here, many of us, probably just about everyone, because I think every country at some point or another was victimized by another country, whose people have been put down in their ancestry, killed, dragged off to whatever, tortured, totally abused, and I happen to come from a nationality where it happened many times over the centuries. It happened, you know, from Genghis Khan to Alexander the Great, and oftentimes it was in under the guise of, we're going to teach compassion. we're going to do all this in the name of teaching you. Well, compassion is an interesting goal, because each one of us will have a different level of what that means to us. So I ask you, if you were to define what's the most important thing you want to accomplish in your career? If I said today, what's the most important thing you want to accomplish? Somebody give me the answer. What is it? What does he want to accomplish today, Grant? Peace, love, and understanding with me, right? That's right. Okay, we're good.
Should be tired.
Right? Add value to others.
Thank you,
Michael. Beautiful.
Go for Michael.
Add value to others. That is a huge thing. Right? To leave them better off than you found them. That care, concern, compassion. So when you look at the share of knowledge you have seen, some of us are really good at learning what's going on in the community. And when we learn that information, when we collaborate, when we share, we end up with more, right? The worst thing you can do in our profession is say, I got my nest egg, and I don't expect money. Because your nest egg, no matter how big of a producer you are, is the smallest percentage of market share versus what the whole industry has overall. So would you rather have what you have and keep it to yourself, or would you rather have a collaborative environment with top 100 people who think just like you and are willing to share? Which one's going to give you the more abundant and more successful life? Collaboration will, by far, is exponentially different answer. Just mean, if you never took on a new client, what would happen to your existing clients over time?
It's a pipe, right? You fill it up and they just keep falling out.
Say that again?
Like a pipe, you just keep on. It's like you just keep putting in new people constantly, but people drip out. So you just have to be adding all the time.
So, Kevin, 100% of the people who started with you in 2005 are still with you today, right? Right? Wouldn't that be great?
Wouldn't that be great?
And nobody who's ever left the industry or retired.
Well, they died too. That's
yeah, that's right. He went there. K-E-D-I-N. O-U-N-T, if you didn't know how he spells it.
8 months, he said, I've got an ass. So, no, that, you know, if you're going to lose a client, that's the only way to watch it.
So let's go through the investor pitch deck real quick and why this is important. When you look at most companies in our marketplace, if you were there, they're going to have their established ownership structure, and there's very little opportunity for people to grow their wealth and build their wealth within the organization. So the multiple streams of ways that we can look at our careers. And oftentimes, we arrive after the fact. So, like as an example, I've been in 2014. I'm going to mention a competitor, although I typically wouldn't. But I was coming into the Austin Marriott, and I had awards in my hand from an award ceremony, and one of the other former big team leaders from Keller Williams says to me, Blake, look, come over here. I want to talk to you about a new model. No. And I thought really quick, and I was like, I'm sorry, I don't want to meet with you because I don't want to be seen with you because that will mean that I'm betraying the company that just showed me loyalty, love, respect here. Just sitting down with you, knowing what the intent of the meeting is, I'm not willing to do it. Now, the next line was that you can make a lot more money. No. Right. Doing the right thing is more important to me than the money. Right. So when I looked and I saw other people meeting with them, I knew the fate of those teams. Fast forward, we're launching this, same company calls, says, would you like to reconsider? I said, no, because I want to do my thing. You're already past the IPO. I want to take a company that has the opportunity, because that's the new world for me. I've done all the other things. You know, when you build things, does that get boring? Mike, you ever get bored of doing the same thing over and over again if it's just the same thing over and over again? I mean, can you imagine if you're pushing a lawnmower and all day long you're just like, Oh, that's only 12 seconds of my day. Feels like I've been here forever. So you surround yourself with people who've done it before, and then you head off on your big adventure. Well, that's kind of what we're doing. So this didn't just like pop out of my head. This is 2 years worth of being consulted by people who have done this, people who are on the back end of our agreement, Joanne's and my ownership, our portion. We're not committing anyone else's portion. We're committing our portion to help grow the company so that everyone can benefit. That makes sense? I'm not coming back to the existing stockholders and saying, I want you to dilute your position to allow these other people to come in. You know, they're the ones who are creating the true value, because they're the ones who are going to build the tech in which the valuation of the company is going to grow by the biggest multiplier. So when we look at what this $5 million that we're seeking by, why are we advertising it? How many of you heard that you put it out into the universe, there's a chance it'll happen, a greater chance it'll happen, right? So I can have my little secret. I can keep it a secret. There's a method to all my madness. So you realize that by pointing it out 10 days ago, I've already had 3 different investor conversations. I've already had Sherry got me into a conversation with someone. Turned out it wasn't right for them, but how have you even heard no before? You know, for some people to get $100 million back on a $5 million valuation and take that risk, that's a massive return on their investment. They do it all day long because they're not going to get that from the stock market typically unless they're pre-IPO with someone else. So let's go through this. So we put out the background of what we're doing, who we are. There's a sheet there, the fact sheet. And this is available for our agents to utilize. Go ahead. It talks about how we're raising the $5 million, what we plan to do with it, and then invites people to a sit down opportunity. Because we're not going to put everything that needs to be in there. It'd be a book this big. Okay. So then we talk about in general what the economic budget looks like as you walk through. So the profit from a single office based on a $700,000 average sales price. Now, is that too high for our market?
No.
Is that unrealistic?
It's a couple hundred thousand bucks.
And the MLS commission average is around 2.3 to 2.35 according to Train Graphics. So we're right there in our percentage. That's actually the same number I used in the original business plan 3.5 years ago. I was using 2.25. Okay. So I'm going to think about the future and what that might look like. And I want to be conservative. So I don't want anybody looking at it saying, oh, no, he's going much higher there. So this is based on 480 transactions from 100 producing agents. We said it would take us 3 years to build it out, and thanks to the pandemic, it's going to take us every bit of those three years to build out the first office. So every office from the point of launch to the point of completion, we tell the investors don't expect a return based on the pro forma of less than 3 years. That a reasonable time to build something. Let alone be on track after going through 2 years of the pandemic. That's the part that I'm really most excited about. Because now the interviews are increasing exponentially. We're meeting with multiple people who are dissatisfied because as the market shifts and people are experiencing what they're experiencing, and they go to their manager who's been in the business for 2 years, yeah. and their manager goes, I don't know how to sell into a 4.75% interest rate market. I don't know what to do. I don't know. I don't have a lender who's had that experience before. You mean you're locked at 3.25% and they won't honor it? Gosh, I'm shocked. What lenders do? They unlock you. Bye. Sue us.
Unlock or close the company.
Right? One or the other. So we laid out our pro forma, our mission statement, who we are, what we do, the 2021 in review, our big stats, some testimonials, and people who have so graciously volunteered their testimonial and their picture and willingness to be seen there. And if you are not there and you want to be, please submit your testimonial along with your picture. Because this is going to go out in a lot of different ways to a lot of different people over time, okay? So it's not just a single snapshot. We're going to freshen it up, change it up, keep it prep, because this is not a single moment experience. It's a process. So is that the end? Oh, yeah, the pride, and then the pride of ownership. So when we look at the pride of ownership, it's important because other people need to know that the agents, what I wanted to prove a year ago, and you proved it, you made it possible to showcase that our belief that this company is worthy of your investment as a person who works here. You see the future of the company as tied to your future in one way or another. That's important because employee buy-in or agent loyalty is an essential part. Can you imagine there are models out there? Some of us have worked in models where they expect and they train that the retention is 30% loss every year. And the attrition is another 10%. So that means 40% of your office is going to turn over every single year. That should horrify any leader of a business. Now you want some turnover. This is just people are going to retire and want to know that they succeeded and they're going to move out of the area. Or do they?
That's why I was looking
at that stuff. The real estate company in the sky. We don't like Kevin up after.
We've
got a company paddle, a real pro 100 paddle.
We'll be the first step.
So, right? Any questions about why we shared the deck? I'm not going through the numbers per se. I just want you to have the ability to become familiar with it. And if you have a high net worth client that you think, you know what, I'm going to introduce you to this idea. If you want to talk to, if they want to sit down with me, I'm happy to sit down. I'm not really interested in practicing this. So if they don't have the money, Please. I'm not, and I don't want anybody risking by refinancing their house to put, you know, or something that's really important to them because they're on the margin expecting this return to be within 24 months and they're gambling, if you will, with their nest egg to, that they need for their future. That's not what I'm talking about. What we want are true venture capitalists who understand what that, you know, they might have a $10 or $20 million portfolio. And they say, I'm willing to put $500,000 at a little bit higher risk. Because there is a higher, you know, there's different levels of risk. You want to buy a 10-year treasury bond, then buy a 10-year treasury bond. If you really believe that a return of 2% back in a 7% inflationary cycle, that they're telling you 7%, which is really probably more like 10 or 12%, that's your choice. I would never buy a treasury bond. It's the stupidest investment you can make, in my opinion. Because if you really believe the government's that solvent and that good, then why would you give them more of your money? They don't need it. Right? I mean, if there's something, they don't need your money. Put a place where you get a better return. So, you know, you wouldn't put money in your mattress if you knew you were going to go back in a year and get, you know, 98% of it back. 2% of it will disappear. In some countries, they have a negative yield on investing in their own country. And they flirted with that idea here over the last couple of years. And I mean, it obviously met with disastrous feedback, like it should. But, you know, the point is that as real estate practitioners, we are creating an environment where we have a different way of looking at things. The way we look at things is primarily through the eyes of how can I establish relationships that when I circle back, the people are glad to see me. So when I talked about that person a year and a half ago, they're now ready. That house will come on the market next week, most likely. Maybe the week after. Their life finally lined up. And what I told them a year and a half ago would be the high end that they could get for the property. So the correlation is when I told them the higher number, what do you think the first thought is regarding the commission? Say that again.
How little will you take?
And we laugh. Because I never answered the question. Seven. Well, it seems obvious. Right? You get 93% of a much bigger number, and also 7% of
the.
And you have to get half of that 7% off.
Yeah.
But it's wonderful to have beautiful people. And this person is the salt of the earth. And if I was standing, if you were standing there, I'd do the same presentation, and you say that's exactly what happened. And we give each other a hug, be nothing but respect and admiration, because those are the kind of clients we want in our lifetime. Because they know that we're seeking out their best interest. Now, do you think that person has a lot of other advisors that are trying to tell me something different?
Of course.
Absolutely.
Oh,
absolutely. And you can't let it rattle. The biggest gift you can give yourself is to be unchained. Unchained from fear of loss, unchained from the results of the outcome. Don't own the outcome. Own the process to the outcome. If you did your absolute best and someone else still says no, Gilbert, what do you get to take home? You did your absolute best or that you lost by doing your absolute best? You did your absolute best, right?
Absolutely.
You told me something. Can I share
yesterday morning?
Oh, yeah. Just to finish out. Mm-hmm. This is a really powerful story. A while back, I got a call from someone I've known 35 years. 35 years is a long time. And they said, I got a high-end client that works with me that has a property they want to sell in San Diego. So, first two agents and I confirmed that were in the rotation. I called. They said no, I don't want. 1.7 million. 1.7. No. But on that subject, we have a new film director starting tomorrow, so Max is here. So we're starting that all over again. So I called it Gilbert. Because Gilbert, you've been a friend of me for 16, 17 years. Long time. No. One of the first in the last model, one of the first in this model. And I said, I know in your past you've always been enthusiastic to go and wherever it takes you. But I got this opportunity and I got a longtime friend who's on the other end, who could be a good referral source because he deals with a lot of high-end clients. Can you take a trip down to Santa Marcos? He says, yeah. He goes there and he involves, has a conversation with Darren and Christian. And they team up. And now that client has moved. They're out of state. They sold that property.
Did you guys have Dublin? No.
No.
But we got a referral.
Referral going the other
way. Thanks to you.
Oh, yeah, that's right. So, well, not mean to write about me, but I mean, write about you got the referral. That was just a team thing. I love helping with the referral. So, if you got an out of area referral, you need help. Don't hesitate. We got to cover. There's so many different ways we can go, and it's super easy. So, just to finish it off, yesterday morning, I see Gilbert. I said, how's it going? He's all great. He goes, remember that client that moved from San Marcos to out of there? And I said, yeah. He said, no, they just called me. They're actually about to settle something in their life where they're going to end up with potentially as many as five high-end properties, five or six high-end properties that will total somewhere around $8 million that they probably want to do a 1031 exchange with. And they've asked me, can I do a 1031 exchange? Do I know how to do it? Do I have a lawyer? Do I have a trust? Do I have all that? Right? Is that fair?
Yeah.
And isn't it nice to say yes?
Yeah.
She
said, why would I even ask you?
Now, in the other companies we worked at together, was that really ever a focus?
No,
no one really ever mentioned it, right? Rarely. Yeah, we always knew we had the ability, but it wasn't the focus. So I'm asking you as you're doing your hunting, look for the people who own lots of property. Because when they decide it's time to sell them, they're gonna leave. There is nothing sweeter than knocking on a door and finding total freedom. Somebody says, oh, how did you know I was thinking about selling? And by the way, I got 10 properties and I'm leaving and I'm going to Idaho or Oregon or wherever I'm leaving to. And I wanna be gone by the end of the summer. Do you think you help me liquidate all my properties? That's truly being unchained from the normal of our profession. In 1978, a band that was created at Pasadena College, David Lee Roth, right, Michael Anthony, Van Halen Brothers, they toured the Southland relentlessly, playing the whiskey, all the places in Southern California, trying to get a label to pay attention to. And one day they're actually in a room playing when Ted Templeman is there looking at another band in the room. And he notices them. Doesn't sign the other people, he signs them. February 1978. Their album comes out and it has two cover songs on it, by the way. You Really Got Me and Ice Cream Man. Those are both cover songs. So they didn't have to be original all the way. They released their album, and 5 months later, I'm watching them in the 113-degree hot summer of Dallas, Texas, at the Cotton Bowl. I'm sure you can see me if you can only stand my big hair. And I believe there were 110,000 people at the concert, pounding the floor. And Van Halen was there. And we were so excited to see him. And unfortunately, Eddie passed and his guitar is silenced. But there's a band that took their music, their early music, and created a career for themselves. And they're called the Atomic Punks, named after one of their songs. And here they are performing Unchained, and they'll be performing at the La Mirage Theater from a canceled show earlier this year because of COVID. So we're getting back to the real world and enjoying the freedom that we had once before. Yeah, hope you enjoy
it. There at the bottom of the screen here. We got another fun number for you here. We're going to go to the I'm gonna get up from here, baby.